In the East, he meant actually India, people tried to live with as little as possible, go on reducing the wants to the absolute minimum. See, can I not live without this? Can I not live without that? So they come to a particular point, drawing the line, making it absolutely minimum. But he says, compared to this, the West went in the other way. They went on increasing the needs and necessities of life, and it became a great burden. So, what really gives us peace of mind is contentment. That is the real wealth for which we should strive, which we should want to have in our life. Then comes the third item, tapas. Literally, the word tap means that which produces heat, which burns, which makes it inconvenient for us at that moment. Dvandva sahanam, dvandvascha, jighatsa pipase, shitoshne, sthana asane, kastha mauna akara maunecha. As I told you earlier, without the help of the standard bhashya or commentary, it is very difficult to understand these works in the form of sutras. For the sutras of Patanjali, the most ancient and most standard commentary is known as Vyasa Bhashya. Who that Vyasa is, we do not know. So he says, tapas means dvandva sahana, putting up with the pairs of opposites, hunger and thirst, for instance, in hot and cold weather, and then whether we are forced to sit or forced to walk. None of these things should have any reaction or action on the mind. We must be able to put up with that and see that they do not upset our mind. The purpose of tapas is, you put up with these difficulties, you bear them, and you will not allow them to upset your mind. Hunger is there, thirst is there, the weather may be cold or hot, naturally it upsets us. But slowly, by repeated practice, if you are able to bear them, withstand them, then we can find that the mind continues to remain at peace. Upavasa parakadi krishra chandrayanadi bhihi sharira shoshanam prahuhu tapasaha tapa uttamam. This is another definition for tapas. Fasting, for instance. And then the vratas called Chandrayana, Krichra, and so on. In Chandrayana Vrata, food is increased and decreased according to the phases of the moon. On Amavasya day you fast. Then Purnima day full meal. So from Amavasya to Purnima, you go on gradually increasing the food. From Purnima to Amavasya, you go on gradually decreasing the food. So that is how this Krishra and Chandrayana are observed according to Dharma Shastras. Sharira Soshanam Prahuhu Tapasaha Tapa Uttamam. Austerity of the body. But a far better definition of tapas is got in the Bhagavad Gita. Deva dvija guru prajna pujanam shaucham arjavam brahmacharyam ahimsacha shariram tapa uchyate. So the Lord has divided tapas into three groups. Tapas of the body, tapas of speech, and tapas of mind. Worshipping or serving God, Brahmanas and gurus, spiritual teachers and others, the wise people, and keeping the body and the surroundings clean, then brahmacharya, controlling the sexual instinct, and ahimsa, not harming others. All these come under sharira tapa, tapas, austerity of the body. And what about the austerity of speech? Anudvegakaram vakyam satyam priyahitam chayat swadhyaya abhyasanam chaiva vangmayam tapa uchyate. Speaking in such a way that it will not harm others, it will not produce tension and unhappiness in the minds of other people. And that speech, sweet speech, should be truthful. Because I want to speak very sweetly, it doesn't mean I can speak anything I like. It must be rooted in truth. It must be satya, it must be priya and hita. It must be pleasant to hear, and it must bring about the good of the person who hears it, who listens to it. Similarly, practicing the chanting of the Vedas learnt in the house of the Guru. Swadhyaya abhyasanam cheiva. All this belongs to the second group, tapas of speech, or the vak indriya, the organ of speech. And what about the mind? Manaprasadaha saumyatvam maunam atma vinigraha bhava samshuddhihi iti etat tapo manasam uchyate. Manaprasadaha, keeping the mind at peace. Saumyatva, you have a pleasant appearance outside, the mind also should feel that pleasantness inside. And then mauna. Mauna doesn't mean observing silence completely. As Ramanuja puts it, mauna is vak pravritti niyamanam. The tendency to speak should be controlled. When it is necessary to speak, we speak. When it is not necessary to speak, we should control. So just speaking as much as is necessary according to the circumstances. This we find as a great quality in Hanuman described by Sri Ramchandra himself. So that is real mauna, observing control of speech. When that comes, it reflects upon the mind also. Atma vinigraha, controlling the passions and prejudices of the mind. And bhava samshuddhihi, purity of emotions. Suppose the mind is full of raga, dvesha, kama, krodha and so on. That mind gets agitated. If that mind is controlled, bhava samshuddhi is there, purity of emotions is there, that is the tapas of the mind. It's not very easy, it's difficult, no doubt, but it is not impossible also. Unless and until we try, we will not be able to succeed. Even a 1,000 miles journey starts with the first step, they say. So once we are convinced about the need for tapas, of the body, of speech and of the mind, we should start doing it. Dale Carnegie has written a book, The Art of Public Speaking. So the very first sentence is, if you want to become a good speaker, start speaking, he says. So that is how we learn. Similarly, try to control speech, control the body, control the mind. So that is about tapas. Then comes swadhyaya. It's a technical word. Swadhyaya and pravachana are compulsory duties for every brahmana who has undergone the training at the Gurukula. That is what the Upanishad says, Taittiriya Upanishad. Swadhyaya pravachana abhyam na pramaditavyam. Swadhyaya is studying the Vedas, understanding them, then what you have studied, what you have understood, that knowledge has to be given to others, distributed to others. Knowledge is the only thing which will not get exhausted when it is given to others. On the other hand, it goes on increasing. So, Swadhyaya is studying of the Vedas and also teaching it to others. Swadhyayo adhyetavyaha. But as far as yoga is concerned, people like Sadashiva Brahmendra, who are great yogis, they have given different definitions for this word. Swadhyayo Gayatri Prabhritinam Mantranam Adhyayanam. There are great Vedic mantras like Gayatri. And repeating the Gayatri and meditating upon the deity indicated by Gayatri, that is Swadhyaya. So there the Vajindriya and the mind both are employed. And Vyasa, in his famous Vyasa Bhashya, puts it in different way. Moksha Shastranam Adhyayanam Pranava Japova. So studying those spiritual sciences which help us to attain moksha, that is also Swadhyaya. In fact, it is used more commonly in this sense. Pranava Japova, or the repetition of the word, the mantra Omkara. Actually, our gurus used to say, and even now that the tradition in our organization, every day we have to spend some time in the study of the Shastras. Upanishads, Bhagavad Gita, for instance. Apart from that, the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna. Even great Swamijis like our Madhavanji and others, every day in the night, before going to bed, they would read the Gospel one or two pages, reflect upon that, then repeat the name of the Lord, maybe 5 malas, 10 malas, then go to bed. So, if we go through the Gospel and also repeat the name of the Lord we have received, which we have received in Mantra Diksha, that will keep the mind in a clean and pure condition, and we will spend the night also in a restful manner. So Swadhyaya is studying of the Vedas. Swadhyaya is repetition of mantras like Gayatri or the mantra given by the Guru. Or studying the scriptures which help us to attain moksha or liberation. Then comes Ishvara Pranidhana. Abhihitanam anabhihitanam cha sarvasam kriyanam parameshvare phala anapekshataya samarpanam. Literally, Ishvara Pranidhana means devotion to the Lord. But how to show the devotion? Suppose there is a person, he is a man of action. He is actually, from morning till night, he has to work as per the dictates of the Shastras, depending upon his varna and ashrama. But whatever work we do, if we are able to offer the fruits and the results of that work to the Lord, it becomes Ishvara Pranidhana. Abhihitanam anabhihitanam cha sarvasam kriyanam parameshvare phala anapekshataya samarpanam. Sometimes we plan and do things. Sometimes we just do things without planning, whether we like it or not. But whatever action has been done by us, ultimately don't desire for its fruits and results, offer it to the Lord, that is Ishvara Pranidhana. So there is a mantra which is supposed to be repeated at the end of the karmas. Kamato akamato vapi yat karomi shubhashubham tat sarvam tvai vinyasya tat prayuktaha karomyaham. This is at the beginning of the day, before beginning the performance of one's duties or discharging one's responsibilities. Whatever I do, whether I do them with desire or unwillingly, willingly or unwillingly, whether it is a good action or a bad action, I will keep or offer all those actions at your feet. You should inspire me to go in the right direction. So in the beginning itself, if you pray and then start doing things, the chances of our going wrong are practically nil, or at least minimized. Stuti smarana puja bhir vangmana kaya karma bhihi sunishchala shire bhaktihi yetat ishvara pujanam. How to worship the Lord, Lord Shiva? By praising Him, by remembering Him, by performing puja, through the speech, through the body, through the mind, and doing them in such a way that our devotion to the Lord increases. That is called Ishvara Pranidhana according to another definition.